This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. The French Third Republic French, La Troisième République, sometimes written as La IIIe République, was the system of government adopted in France from 1870, when the Second French Empire collapsed, until 1940, when France's defeat by Nazi Germany in World War II led to the formation of the Vichy government in France. It came to an end on 10 July 1940. The early days of the Third Republic were dominated by political disruptions caused by the Franco-Prussian War of 1870-71, which the Republic continued to wage after the fall of Emperor Napoleon III in 1870. Harsh reparations exacted by the Prussians after the war resulted in the loss of the French regions of Alsace in its entirety and Lorraine, the northeastern part, i.e. present-day département de la Moselle, social upheaval, and the establishment of the Paris Commune. The early governments of the Third Republic considered re-establishing the monarchy, but confusion as to the nature of that monarchy and who should be awarded the throne caused those talks to stall. Thus, the Third Republic, which was originally intended as a provisional government, instead became the permanent government of France. The French constitutional laws of 1875 defined the composition of the Third Republic. It consisted of a chamber of deputies and a senate to form the legislative branch of government and a president to serve as head of state. Issues over the re-establishment of the monarchy dominated the tenures of the first two presidents, Adolphe Thiers and Patrice de McMahon, but the growing support for the republican form of government in the French population in a series of republican presidents during the 1880s quashed all plans for a monarchical restoration. The Third Republic established many French colonial possessions, including French Indochina, French Madagascar, French Polynesia, and large territories in West Africa during the scramble for Africa, all of them acquired during the last two decades of the 19th century. The early years of the 20th century were dominated by the Democratic Republican Alliance, which was originally conceived as a center-left political alliance, but over time became the main center-right party. The period from the start of World War I to the late 1930s featured sharply polarized politics, between the Democratic Republican Alliance and the more radical socialists. The government fell during the early years of World War II as the Germans occupied France and was replaced by the rival governments of Charles de Gaulle's Free France, La France Libre, and Philippe Pétain's Vichy France. L'état français. Adolphe Thiers called republicanism in the 1870s the form of government that divides France least. However, politics under the Third Republic were sharply polarized. On the left stood reformist France, heir to the French Revolution. On the right stood conservative France, rooted in the peasantry, the Roman Catholic Church, and the army. In spite of France's sharply divided electorate and persistent attempts to overthrow it, the Third Republic endured for 70 years, which makes it the longest-lasting system of government in France since the collapse of the ancien régime in 1789. Contents. 1. Politics. 11. Parliamentary monarchy. 12. The ordre moral government. 13. The opportunist republicans. 14. Boulanger crisis. 15. Panama scandal. 16. Laggard welfare state and public health. 2. Dreyfus affair. 3. Social history. 31. Newspapers. 32. Modernization of the peasants. 33. Consumerism and the city department store. 4. French colonial empire. 5. The radicals republic. 6. Church and state. 7. Foreign policy. 71-1871-1900-72-1900-1914-8 First World War. 9. Peace. 10-1919-1939-101 Great Depression. 102 Foreign policy. 103 The Popular Front. 104 Conservatism. 105 Relations with Catholicism. 11 Downfall of the Third Republic. 12 Interpreting the Third Republic. 13 Historiography of Decadence. 14 Timeline to 1914. 15 See also. 16 Notes. 17 Bibliography. 171 Surveys. 172 Foreign policy and colonies. 173 Political ideas and practice. 174 Culture and society. 175 Women, sexuality, gender. 176 World War I politics. Main article, Franco-Prussian War. A French propaganda poster from 1917 is captioned with an 18th century quote. Even in 1788, Mirabeau was saying that war is the national industry of Prussia. The Franco-Prussian War of 1870–1871 resulted in the defeat of France and the overthrow of Emperor Napoleon III and his Second French Empire after Napoleon's capture by the Prussians at the Battle of Sedan 1 September 1870. Parisian deputies led by Léon Gambetta established the Government of National Defense as a provisional government on 4 September 1870. The deputies selected General Louis Jules Trocu to serve as its president. This first government of the Third Republic ruled during the Siege of Paris, the 19th of September 1870 to the 28th of January 1871, as Paris was cut off from the rest of unoccupied France. The Minister of War, Léon Gambetta, who succeeded to leave Paris in a hot air balloon, established the headquarters of the Provisional Republican Government in the city of Tours on the Loire River after the French surrender in January 1871, the Provisional Government of National Defense disbanded, and national elections were called with the aim of creating a new French government. French territories occupied by Prussia at this time did not participate. The resulting Conservative National Assembly elected Adolphe Thiers as head of a provisional government, nominally head of the executive branch of the Republic, pending a decision on the institutions of France. Due to the revolutionary and left-wing political climate that prevailed in the Parisian population, the right-wing government chose the Royal Palace of Versailles as its headquarters. The new government negotiated a peace settlement with the newly proclaimed German Empire. The Treaty of Frankfurt, signed on 10 May 1871 to prompt the Prussians to leave France. The government passed a variety of financial laws, such as the controversial Law of Maturities, to pay reparations in Paris. Resentment against the government built, and from late March to May 1871, Paris workers and National Guards revolted and established the Paris Commune, which maintained a radical left-wing regime for 2 months until its bloody suppression by the Thiers government in May 1871. The following repression of the Communards would have disastrous consequences for the labor movement. Parliamentary monarchy, composition of the National Assembly 1871. The French legislative election of 1871, held in the aftermath of the collapse of the regime of Napoleon III, resulted in a monarchist majority in the French National Assembly that was favorable to making a peace agreement with Prussia. The legitimists in the National Assembly supported the candidacy of a descendant of King Charles X, the last monarch from the senior line of the Bourbon dynasty, to assume the French throne, his grandson Henri, Comte de Chambord, alias Henry V. The Orléanists supported a descendant of King Louis-Philippe I, the cousin of Charles X who replaced him as the French monarch in 1830. His grandson Louis-Philippe, Comte de Paris. The Bonapartists were marginalized due to the defeat of Napoleon III and were unable to advance the candidacy of any member of his family. The Bonaparte family, legitimists and Orléanists, came to a compromise, eventually, whereby the childless Comte de Chambord would be recognized as king, with the Comte de Paris recognized as his heir. Consequently, in 1871 the throne was offered to the Comte de Chambord. Chambord believed the restored monarchy had to eliminate all traces of the revolution, including most famously the tricolor flag, in order to restore the unity between the monarchy and the nation, which the revolution had sundered. Compromise on this was impossible if the nation were to be made whole again. The general population, however, was unwilling to abandon the tricolor flag. Monarchists therefore resigned themselves to wait for the death of the aging, childless Chambord, when the throne could be offered to his more liberal heir, the Comte de Paris. A temporary republican government was therefore established. Chambord lived on until 1883, but by that time, enthusiasm for a monarchy had faded, and the Comte de Paris was never offered the French throne. The Ordre Moral Government. Further information, the 16th of May 1877 crisis. The Sacre Coeur Basilica was built as a symbol of the Ordre Moral in France. Children were taught in school not to forget the lost regions of Alsace-Lorraine, which were colored in black on maps. The term Ordre Moral, moral order, was applied to the policies of the early governments of the Third Republic in reference to the bloody suppression of the Paris Commune, whose political and social innovations were viewed as morally degenerate by large conservative segments of the French population. In February 1875, a series of parliamentary acts established the constitutional laws of the new republic. At its head was a president of the republic, a two-chamber parliament consisting of a directly elected chamber of deputies and an indirectly elected senate was created, along with a ministry under the president of the council prime minister, who was nominally answerable to both the president of the Republic and the legislature. Throughout the 1870s, the issue of whether a monarchy should replace the Republic dominated public debate. On 16 May 1877, with public opinion swinging heavily in favor of a Republic, the President of the Republic, Patrice de McMahon, himself a monarchist, made one last desperate attempt to salvage the monarchical cause by dismissing the Republican Prime Minister Jules Simon and appointing the monarchist leader Albert, Duc de Broglie, to office. He then dissolved Parliament and called a general election for the following October. If his hope had been to halt the move towards republicanism, it backfired spectacularly, with the president being accused of having staged a constitutional coup d'état known as Le 6 Mai, the 16th of May crisis, after the date on which it happened. Indeed, it was not until Charles de Gaulle, 80 years later, that a president of France next unilaterally dissolved Parliament. Republicans returned triumphantly after the October elections for the Chamber of Deputies. The prospect of a monarchical restoration died definitively after the Republicans gained control of the Senate on 5 January 1879. McMahon himself resigned on 30 January 1879, leaving a seriously weakened presidency in the hands of Jules Grévy, the opportunist Republicans. Further information: opportunist Republicans following the 16th of May crisis in 1877, legitimists were pushed out of power, and the Republic was finally governed by Republicans referred to as opportunist Republicans for their support of moderate social and political changes in order to establish the new regime firmly. The Jules Ferry laws that made public education free, mandatory, and secular laïque were voted in 1881. And 1882, one of the first signs of the expanding civic powers of the Republic. From that time onward, public education was no longer under the exclusive control of the Catholic congregations. To discourage French monarchism as a serious political force, the French crown jewels were broken up and sold in 1885. Only a few crowns, their precious gems replaced by colored glass, were kept. Boulanger crisis. Georges Ernest Boulanger, nicknamed General Revanche in 1889, the Republic was rocked by a sudden political crisis precipitated by General Georges Boulanger, an enormously popular general. He won a series of elections in which he would resign his seat in the Chamber of Deputies and run again in another district. At the apogee of his popularity in January 1889, he posed the threat of a coup d'état and the establishment of a dictatorship with his base of support in the working districts of Paris and other cities, plus rural traditionalist Catholics and royalists. He promoted an aggressive nationalism aimed against Germany. The elections of September 1889 marked a decisive defeat for the Boulangists. They were defeated by the changes in the electoral laws that prevented Boulanger from running in multiple constituencies, by the government's aggressive opposition, and by the absence of the general himself, who placed himself in self-imposed exile to be with his mistress the fall. A Boulanger severely undermined the political strength of the conservative and royalist elements within France. They would not recover their strength until 1940. Revisionist scholars have argued that the Boulangist movement more often represented elements of the radical left rather than the extreme right. Their work is part of an emerging consensus that France's radical right was formed in part during the Dreyfus era by men who had been Boulangist partisans of the radical left a decade earlier. Panama scandal. Main article: Panama scandals. The Panama scandals of 1892 involved the enormous cost of a failed attempt to build the Panama Canal due to disease, death, inefficiency, and widespread corruption. The Panama Canal Company handling the massive project went bankrupt, with millions in losses. It is regarded as the largest monetary corruption scandal of the 19th century. Close to $1 billion were lost when the French government took bribes to keep quiet about the Panama Canal Company's financial troubles. Laggard welfare. State and public health. France was laggard behind Bismarckian Germany, as well as Great Britain, in developing the welfare state, including a public health, unemployment insurance, and a national old age pension plan. There was an accident insurance law for workers in 1898, and in 1910 the national pension plan started. Unlike Germany or Britain, the programs were much smaller. For example, pensions were a voluntary plan. Smith finds French fears of national public assistance programs were grounded in a widespread disdain for the English poor law. Tuberculosis was the most dreaded disease of the day, especially striking young people in their 20s. Germany set up vigorous measures of public hygiene and public sanatoria, but France let private physicians handle the problem, which left it with a much higher death rate. The French medical profession jealously guarded its prerogatives, and public health activists were not as well organized or as influential as in Germany, Britain, or the United States. For example, there was a long battle over a public health law which began in the 1880s as a campaign to reorganize the nation's health services, to require the registration of infectious diseases, to mandate quarantines, and to improve the deficient health and housing legislation of 1850. However, the reformers met opposition from bureaucrats, politicians, and physicians because it was so threatening to so many interests, the proposal was debated and postponed for 20 years before becoming law in 1902. Success finally came when the government realized that contagious diseases had a national security impact in weakening military recruits, and keeping the population growth rate well below Germany's Dreyfus Affair main article, Dreyfus Affair. The Dreyfus Affair was a major political scandal that convulsed France from 1894 until its resolution in 1906, and then had reverberations for decades more. The conduct of the affair has become a modern and universal symbol of injustice. It remains one of the most striking examples of a complex miscarriage of justice in which a central role was played by the press and public opinion. At issue was blatant antisemitism as practiced by the French army and defended by conservatives and Catholic traditionalists against secular center-left, left and Republican forces, including most Jews. In the end, the latter triumphed. Captain Alfred Dreyfus. The affair began in November 1894 with the conviction for treason of Captain Alfred Dreyfus, a young French artillery officer of Alsatian Jewish descent. He was sentenced to life imprisonment for communicating French military secrets to the German embassy in Paris and sent to the penal colony at Devil's Island in French Guiana, nicknamed La Guillotine Sèche, the Dry Guillotine, where he spent almost 5 years. 2 years later, evidence came to light that identified a French army major named Ferdinand Walson Esterhazy as the real spy. After high-ranking military officials suppressed the new evidence, a military court unanimously acquitted Esterhazy. In response, the army brought up additional charges against Dreyfus based on false documents. Word of the military court's attempts to frame Dreyfus began to spread, chiefly owing to the polemic J'accuse, a vehement open letter published in a Paris newspaper in January 1898 by the notable writer Émile Zola. Activists put pressure on the government to reopen the case in 1899. Dreyfus was returned to France for another trial. The intense political and judicial scandal that ensued divided French society between those who supported Dreyfus, now called Dreyfusards, such as Anatole France, Henri Poincaré and Georges Clemenceau, and those who condemned him, the anti-Dreyfusards, such as Édouard Drumont, the director and publisher of the anti-Semitic newspaper La Libre Parole. The new trial resulted in another conviction and a 10-year sentence, but Dreyfus was given a pardon and set free. Eventually, all the accusations against him were demonstrated to be baseless, and in 1906, Dreyfus was exonerated and reinstated as a major in the French army from 1894 to 1906. The scandal divided France deeply and lastingly into two opposing camps: the pro-army anti-Dreyfusards, composed of conservatives, Catholic traditionalists, and monarchists, who generally lost the initiative to the anti-clerical, pro-Republican Dreyfusards. With strong support from intellectuals and teachers, it embittered French politics and facilitated the increasing influence of radical politicians on both sides of the political spectrum. Social history newspapers. The democratic political structure was supported by the proliferation of politicized newspapers. The circulation of the daily press in Paris went from 1 million in 1870 to 5 million in 1910. It later reached 6 million in 1939. Advertising grew rapidly, providing a steady financial basis for publishing, but it did not cover all of the costs involved and had to be supplemented by secret subsidies from commercial interests that wanted favorable reporting. A new liberal press law of 1881 abandoned the restrictive practices that had been typical for a century. High-speed rotary hoe presses, introduced in the 1860s, facilitated quick turnaround time and cheaper publication. New types of popular newspapers, especially Le Petit Journal, reached an audience more interested in diverse entertainment and gossip than hard news. It captured a quarter of the Parisian market and forced the rest to lower their prices. The main dailies employed their own journalists who competed for news flashes. All newspapers relied upon the Agence Havas, now Agence France Press, a telegraphic news service with a network of reporters and contracts with Reuters to provide world service. The state-owned papers retained their loyal clientele because of their concentration on serious political issues, while papers usually gave false circulation figures. Le Petit Provincial in 1913 probably had a daily circulation of about 100,000, and Le Petit Meridional had about 70,000. Advertising only filled 20% or so of the pages. The Roman Catholic Assumptionist order revolutionized pressure group media by its national Newspaper La Croix it vigorously advocated for traditional Catholicism while at the same time innovating with the most modern technology and distribution systems, with regional editions tailored to local taste. Secularists and Republicans recognized the newspaper as their greatest enemy, especially when it took the lead in attacking Dreyfus as a traitor and stirring up antisemitism after Dreyfus was pardoned. The radical government closed down the entire Assumptionist order and its newspaper in 1900. Banks secretly paid certain newspapers to promote particular financial interests and hide or cover up misbehavior. They also took payments for favorable notices in news articles of commercial products. Sometimes, a newspaper would blackmail a business by threatening to publish unfavorable information unless the business immediately started advertising in the paper. Foreign governments, especially Russia and Turkey, secretly paid the press hundreds of thousands of francs a year to guarantee favorable coverage of the bonds it was selling in Paris when the real news was bad about Russia, as during its 1905 revolution or during its war with Japan. It raised the ante to millions during the World War. Newspapers became more of a propaganda agency on behalf of the war effort and avoided critical commentary. They seldom reported the achievements of the Allies, crediting all the good news to the French army. In a word, the newspapers were not independent champions of the truth, but secretly paid advertisements for banking. The World War ended a golden era for the press. Their younger staff members were drafted, and male replacements could not be found. Female journalists were not considered suitable. Rail transportation was rationed and less paper and ink came in, and fewer copies could be shipped out. Inflation raised the price of newsprint, which was always in short supply. The cover price went up, circulation fell, and many of the 242 dailies published outside Paris closed down. The government set up the Interministerial Press Commission to supervise the press closely. A separate agency imposed tight censorship that led to blank spaces where news reports or editorials were disallowed. The dailies sometimes were limited to only 2 pages instead of the usual 4, leading one satirical paper to try to report the war news in the same spirit. War news: a half Zeppelin threw half its bombs on half-time combatants, resulting in one quarter damage. The Zeppelin, halfways attacked by a portion of half anti-aircraft guns, was half destroyed. Regional newspapers flourished after 1900. However, the Parisian newspapers were largely stagnant after the war. The major post-war success story was Paris Soir, which lacked any political agenda and was dedicated to providing a mix of sensational reporting to aid circulation and serious articles to build prestige. By 1939, its circulation was over 17 million, double that of its nearest rival, the tabloid Le Petit Parisien. In addition to its daily paper, Paris Soir sponsored a highly successful women's magazine, Marie Claire. Another magazine, Match, was modeled after the photojournalism of the American magazine Life. Modernization of the peasants. France was a rural nation, and the peasant farmer was the typical French citizen. In his seminal book Peasants into Frenchmen 1976, historian Eugene Weber traced the modernization of French villages and argued that rural France went from backward and isolated to modern with a sense of national identity. During the late 19th and early 20th centuries, he emphasized the roles of railroads, republican schools, and universal military conscription. He based his findings on school records, migration patterns, military service documents, and economic trends. Weber argued that until 1900 or so, a sense of French nationhood was weak in the provinces. Weber then looked at how the policies of the Third Republic created a sense of French nationality in rural areas. Weber's scholarship was widely praised, but was criticized by some who argued that a sense of Frenchness existed in the provinces before 1870. Consumerism and the city department store Au Bon Marché. Aristide Boussicault founded Le Bon Marché in Paris in 1838, and by 1852 it offered a wide variety of goods in departments inside one building. Goods were sold at fixed prices, with guarantees that allowed exchanges and refunds. By the end of the 19th century, Georges Dufayel, a French credit merchant, had served up to 3 million customers and was affiliated with Le Samaritain, a large French department store established in 1870 by a former Bon Marché executive. The French gloried in the national prestige brought by the great Parisian stores. The great writer Émile Zola 1840-1902 set his novel Au Bonheur des Dames 1882-83 in the typical department store. Zola represented it as a symbol of the new technology that was both improving society and devouring it. The novel describes merchandising, management techniques, marketing, and consumer consumerism, the Grand Magasins du Fayol was a huge department store with inexpensive prices built in 1890 in the northern part of Paris, where it reached a very large new customer base in the working class in a neighborhood with few public spaces. It provided a consumer version of the public square. It educated workers to approach shopping as an exciting social activity, not just a routine exercise in obtaining necessities, just as the bourgeoisie did at the famous department stores in the central city like the bourgeois stores. It helped transform consumption from a business transaction into a direct relationship between consumer and sought-after goods. Its advertisements promised the opportunity to participate in the newest, most fashionable consumerism at reasonable cost. The latest technology was featured, such as cinemas and exhibits of inventions like X-ray machines that could be used to fit shoes and the gramophone. Increasingly after 1870, the store's workforce became feminized, opening up prestigious job opportunities for young women despite the low pay and long hours. They enjoyed the exciting complex interactions with the newest and most fashionable merchandise and upscale customers. French Colonial Empire Monument in Bonifacio commemorating the soldiers of the French Foreign Legion killed on duty for France during the South Oronet Campaign 1897-1902. The Third Republic, in line with the imperialistic ethos of the day sweeping Europe, developed a French colonial empire. The largest and most important were in French North Africa and French Indochina. French administrators, soldiers, and missionaries were dedicated to bringing French civilization to the local populations of these colonies. The mission civilizatrice. Some French businessmen went overseas, but there were few permanent settlements. The Catholic Church became deeply involved. Its missionaries were unattached men committed to staying permanently, learning local languages and customs, and converting the natives to Christianity. France successfully integrated the colonies into its economic system by 1939. One-third of its exports went to its colonies. Paris businessmen invested heavily in agriculture, mining, and shipping in Indochina. New plantations were opened for rubber and rice in Algeria. Land held by rich settlers rose from 1,600,000 hectares in 1890 to 2,700,000 hectares in 1940. Combined with similar operations in Morocco and Tunisia, the result was that North African agriculture became one of the most efficient in the world. Metropolitan France was a captive market, so large landowners could borrow large sums in Paris to modernize agricultural techniques with tractors and mechanized equipment. The result was a dramatic increase in the export of wheat, corn, peaches, and olive oil. French Algeria became the fourth most important wine producer in the world. Opposition to colonial rule led to rebellions in Morocco in 1925, Syria in 1926, and Indochina in 1930, all of which the colonial army quickly suppressed. The Radicals. Republic. The most important party in France of the early 20th century in France was the Radical Party, founded in 1901 as the Republican, Radical and Radical Socialist Party, Parti Républicain, Radical et Radical Socialist. It was classically liberal in political orientation and opposed the monarchists and clerical elements on the one hand, and the socialists on the other. Many members had been recruited by the Freemasons. The Radicals were split between activists who called for state intervention to achieve economic and social equality and conservatives whose first priority was stability. The workers' demands for strikes threatened such stability and pushed many radicals toward conservatism. It opposed women's suffrage for fear that women would vote for its opponents or for candidates endorsed by the Catholic Church. It favored a progressive income tax, economic equality, expanded educational opportunities and cooperatives in domestic policy and foreign policy. It favored a strong League of Nations after the war, and the maintenance of peace through compulsory arbitration, controlled disarmament, economic sanctions, and perhaps an international military force. Followers of Léon Gambetta, such as Raymond Poincaré, who would become president of the Council in the 1920s, created the Democratic Republican Alliance ARD, which became the main center-right party after World War I. Governing coalitions collapsed with regularity, rarely lasting more than a few months, as radicals, socialists, liberals, conservatives, republicans and monarchists all fought for control. Some historians argue that the collapses were not important because they reflected minor changes in coalitions of many parties that routinely lost and gained a few allies. Consequently, the change of governments could be seen as little more than a series of ministerial reshuffles, with many individuals carrying forward from one government to the next, often in the same posts. Church and state. See also, Martin of Tours section. Republic separation of the church and the state in 1905. Throughout the lifetime of the Third Republic 1870-1940, there were battles over the status of the Catholic Church in France among the republicans, monarchists and the authoritarians such as the Napoleonists. The French clergy and bishops were closely associated with the monarchists and many of its hierarchy were from noble families. Republicans were based in the anti-clerical middle class, who saw the church's alliance with the monarchists as a political threat to republicanism, and a threat to the modern spirit of progress. The Republicans detested the Church for its political and class affiliations. For them, the Church represented the ancient regime, a time in French history most Republicans hoped was long behind them. The Republicans were strengthened by Protestant and Jewish support. Numerous laws were passed to weaken the Catholic Church in 1879. Priests were excluded from the administrative committees of hospitals and boards of charity. In 1880, new measures were directed against the religious congregations. From 1880 to 1890 came the substitution of lay women for nuns in many hospitals. In 1882, the Fairy School Laws were passed. Napoleon's Concordat of 1801 continued in operation, but in 1881, the government cut off salaries to priests it disliked. The first page of the bill, as brought before the Chambre des Députés in 1905, Republicans feared that religious orders in control of schools, especially the Jesuits and Assumptionists, indoctrinated anti-republicanism into children. Determined to root this out, Republicans insisted they needed control of the schools for France to achieve economic and militaristic progress. Republicans felt one of the primary reasons for the German victory in 1870 was their superior education system. The early anti-Catholic laws were largely the work of Republican Jules Ferry in 1882. Religious instruction in all schools was forbidden, and religious orders were forbidden to teach in them. Funds were appropriated from religious schools to build more state schools later in the century. Other laws passed by Ferry's successors further weakened the church's position in French society. Civil marriage became compulsory, divorce was introduced, and chaplains were removed from the army. When Leo XIII became pope in 1878, he tried to calm church-state relations. In 1884, he told French bishops not to act in a hostile manner toward the state, Noblissima Gallorum Gens. In 1892, he issued an encyclical advising French Catholics to rally to the Republic and defend the Church by participating in Republican politics, Au milieu des sollicitudes. This attempt at improving the relationship failed. Deep-rooted suspicions remained on both sides and were inflamed by the Dreyfus Affair 1894-1906. Catholics were for the most part anti-Dreyfusard. The Assumptionists published anti-Semitic and anti-Republican articles in their journal La Croix. This infuriated Republican politicians, who were eager to take revenge often. They worked in alliance with Masonic lodges, the Waldeck-Rousseau Ministry 1899-1902 and the Combes Ministry 1902-05, fought with the Vatican over the appointment of bishops. Chaplains were removed from naval and military hospitals in the years 1903 and 1904, and soldiers were ordered not to frequent Catholic clubs. In 1904, Emile Combes, when elected Prime Minister in 1902, was determined to defeat Catholicism thoroughly. After only a short while in office, he closed down all parochial schools in France. Then he had Parliament reject authorization of all religious orders. This meant that all 54 orders in France were dissolved and about 20,000 members immediately left France, many for Spain. In 1904, Émile Loubet, the President of France from 1899 to 1906, visited King Victor Emmanuel III of Italy in Rome, and Pope Pius X protested at this recognition of the Italian state. Combes reacted strongly and recalled his ambassador to the Holy See. Then, in 1905, a law was introduced that abrogated Napoleon's 1801 Concordat. Church and state were finally separated. All church property was confiscated. Religious personnel were no longer paid by the state. Public worship was given over to associations of Catholic laymen who controlled access to churches. However, in practice, masses and rituals continued to be performed. The Combes government worked with Masonic lodges to create a secret surveillance of all army officers to make sure that devout Catholics would not be promoted. Exposed as the Affaire des Fiches, the scandal undermined support for the Combes government, and he resigned. It also undermined morale in the army, as officers realized that hostile spies examining their private lives were more important to their careers than their own professional accomplishments. In December 1905, the government of Maurice Rouvier introduced the French law on the separation of church and state. This law was heavily supported by Combes, who had been strictly enforcing the 1901 Voluntary Association Law and the 1904 Law on Religious Congregations' Freedom of Teaching. On 10 February 1905, the Chamber declared that the attitude of the Vatican had rendered the separation of church and state inevitable, and the law of the separation of church and state was passed in December 1905. The church was badly hurt and lost half its priests in the long run. However, it gained autonomy ever after. The state no longer had a voice in choosing bishops. Thus Gallicanism was dead. Foreign policy. French foreign policy from 1871 to 1914 showed a dramatic transformation from a humiliated power with no friends and not much of an empire in 1871, to the centerpiece of the European alliance system in 1914, with a flourishing empire that was second in size only to Great Britain. Although religion was a hotly contested matter and domestic politics, the Catholic Church made missionary work and church building a specialty in the colonies. Most Frenchmen ignored foreign policy. Its issues were a low priority in politics 1871 to 1900. French foreign policy was based on a fear of Germany, whose larger size and fast-growing economy could not be matched, combined with a revanchism that demanded the return of Alsace and Lorraine at the same time. Imperialism was a factor in the midst of the scramble for Africa. French and British interest in Africa came into conflict. The most dangerous episode was the Fashoda incident of 1898, when French troops tried to claim an area in the southern Sudan, and a British force purporting to be acting in the interests of the Khedive of Egypt arrived under heavy pressure. The French withdrew, securing Anglo-Egyptian control over the area. The status quo was recognized by an agreement between the two states acknowledging British control over Egypt, while France became the dominant power in Morocco. But France suffered a humiliating defeat overall. The Suez Canal, initially built by the French, became a joint British-French project in 1875, as both saw it as vital to maintaining their influence and empires in Asia. In 1882, ongoing civil disturbances in Egypt prompted Britain to intervene, extending a hand to France. The government allowed Britain to take effective control of Egypt. France had colonies in Asia and looked for alliances, and found in Japan a possible ally. At Japan's request, Paris sent military missions in 1872-1880, in 1884-1889, and in 1918-1919 to help modernize the Japanese army. Conflicts with China over Indochina climaxed during the Sino-French War 1884-1885. Admiral Corbett destroyed the Chinese fleet anchored at Fuzhou. The treaty ending the war put France in a protectorate over northern and central Vietnam, which it divided into Tonkin and Annam under the leadership of expansionist Jules Ferry. The Third Republic greatly expanded the French colonial empire. Catholic missionaries played a major role. France acquired Indochina, Madagascar, vast territories in West Africa and Central Africa, and much of Polynesia 1900-1914. Main articles: Entente Cordiale, Franco-Russian Alliance, and Triple Entente. Marianne left Mother Russia Center and Britannia Right, personifying the Triple Entente as opposed to the Triple Alliance, in an effort to isolate Germany. France went to great pains to woo Russia and Great Britain, first by means of the Franco-Russian Alliance of 1894, then the 1904 Entente Cordiale with Great Britain, and finally the Anglo-Russian Entente in 1907, which became the Triple Entente. This alliance with Britain and Russia against Germany and Austria eventually led Russia and Britain to enter World War I as France's allies. French foreign policy in the years leading up to the First World War was based largely on hostility to and fear of German power. France secured an alliance with the Russian Empire in 1894 after diplomatic talks between Germany and Russia had failed to produce any working agreement. The Franco-Russian alliance served as the cornerstone of French foreign policy until 1917. A further link with Russia was provided by vast French investments and loans before 1914. In 1904, French Foreign Minister Théophile Delcasse negotiated the Entente Cordiale with Lord Lansdowne, the British Foreign Secretary, an agreement that ended a long period of Anglo-French tensions and hostility. The Entente Cordiale, which functioned as an informal Anglo-French alliance, was further strengthened by the first and second Moroccan crises of 1905 and 1911, and by secret military and naval staff talks. Delcasse's rapprochement with Britain was controversial in France, as Anglophobia was prominent around the start of the 20th century, sentiments that had been much reinforced by the Fashoda incident of 1898, in which Britain and France had almost gone to war, and by the Boer War, in which French public opinion was very much on the side of Britain's enemies. Ultimately, the fear of German power was the link that bound Britain and France together. Preoccupied with internal problems, France paid little attention to foreign policy in the period between late 1912 and mid-1914, although it did extend military service to 3 years from two over strong socialist objections in 1913. The rapidly escalating Balkan crisis of July 1914 surprised France, and not much attention was given to conditions that led to the outbreak of World War I. First World War II. Also, French Army in World War I and Home Front during World War I. Section. French poilus sustained the highest number of casualties among the Allies in World War I. France entered World War I because Russia and Germany were going to war, and France honored its treaty obligations to Russia. Decisions were all made by senior officials, especially President Raymond Poincaré, Premier and Foreign Minister René Viviani, and the ambassador to Russia Maurice Palaiolog. Not involved in the decision-making were military leaders, arms manufacturers, the newspapers, pressure groups, party leaders, or spokesmen for French nationalism. Britain wanted to remain neutral but entered the war when the German army invaded Belgium on its way to Paris. The French victory at the Battle of the Marne in September 1914 ensured the failure of Germany's strategy to win quickly. It became a long and very bloody war of attrition, but France emerged on the winning side. French intellectuals welcomed the war to avenge the humiliation of defeat and loss of territory in 1871 at the grassroots. Paul Déroulède's League of Patriots, a proto-fascist movement based in the lower middle class, had advocated a war of revenge since the 1880s. The strong socialist movement had long opposed war and preparation for war. However, when its leader Jean Jaurès, a pacifist, was assassinated at the start of the war, the French socialist movement abandoned its anti-militarist positions and joined the national war effort. Prime Minister René Viviani called for unity in the form of a «Union sacrée» sacred union, and in France there were few dissenters. A state of emergency was proclaimed and censorship imposed, leading to the creation in 1915 of the satirical newspaper Le Canard Enchaîné to bypass the censorship. The economy was hurt by the German invasion of major industrial areas in the northeast, although the occupied area in 1914 contained only 14% of France's industrial workers. It produced 58% of the steel and 40% of the coal in 1914. The government implemented a war economy with controls and rationing. By 1915, the war economy went into high gear, as millions of French women and colonial men replaced the civilian roles of many of the 3 million soldiers. Considerable assistance came with the influx of American food, money and raw materials in 1917. This war economy would have important reverberations after the war, as it would be a first breach of liberal theories of non-interventionism. The damages caused by the war amounted to about 113% of the gross domestic product GDP of 1913, chiefly the destruction of productive capital and housing. The national debt rose from 66% of GDP in 1913 to 170% in 1919, reflecting the heavy use of bond issues to pay for the war. Inflation was severe, with the franc losing over half its value against the British pound to uplift the French national spirit. Many intellectuals began to fashion patriotic propaganda. The Union Sacrée sought to draw the French people closer to the actual front and thus garner social, political, and economic support for the soldiers. After the French army successfully defended Paris in 1914, the conflict became one of trench warfare along the Western Front. With very high casualty rates, it became a war of attrition until spring of 1918. Amazing as it seems, there were almost no territorial gains or losses for either side. Georges Clemenceau, whose ferocious energy and determination earned him the nickname Le Tigre, the Tiger, led a coalition government after 1917 that was determined to defeat Germany. Meanwhile, large swaths of northeastern France fell under the brutal control of German occupiers. Peace. The Council of Four in Versailles, 1919, David Lloyd George of Britain, Vittorio Emanuele Orlando of Italy, Georges Clemenceau of France and Woodrow Wilson of the U.S. A quick change of fortunes in the late summer and autumn of 1918 saw the defeat of Germany in World War I. The most important factors that led to the surrender of Germany were its exhaustion after 4 years of fighting and the arrival of large numbers of troops from the United States beginning in the summer of 1918. Peace terms were imposed on Germany by the Big Four, Great Britain, France, the United States, and Italy. Clemenceau demanded the harshest terms and won most of them in the Treaty of Versailles in 1919. Germany was largely disarmed and forced to take full responsibility for the war, meaning that it was expected to pay huge war reparations. France regained Alsace-Lorraine, and the German industrial Saar Basin, a coal and Steel region, was occupied by France. The German African colonies, such as Cameroon, were partitioned between France and Britain from the remains of the Ottoman Empire, Germany's ally during World War I that also collapsed at the end of the conflict. France acquired the Mandate of Syria and the Mandate of Lebanon 1919-1939. French soldiers observing the Rhine at Deutscheseck, Koblenz, during the occupation of the Rhineland from 1919 to 1940, France was governed by two main groupings of political alliances. On the one hand, there was the right-centre Bloc National led by Georges Clemenceau, Raymond Poincaré and Aristide Briand. The Bloc was supported by business and finance and was friendly toward the army and the church. Its main goals were revenge against Germany, economic prosperity for French business and stability in domestic affairs. On the other hand, there was the left-centre Cartel des Gauches dominated by Édouard Herriot of the Radical Socialist Party. Herriot's party was in fact neither radical nor socialist, rather it represented the interests of small business and the lower middle class. It was intensely anti-clerical and resisted the Catholic Church. The cartel was occasionally willing to form a coalition with the Socialist Party. Anti-democratic groups, such as the Communists on the left and Royalists on the right, played relatively minor roles. The flow of reparations from Germany played a central role in strengthening French finances. The government began a large-scale reconstruction program to repair wartime damages, and was burdened with a very large public debt. Taxation policies were inefficient, with widespread evasion, and when the financial crisis grew worse in 1926, Poincaré levied new taxes, reformed the system of tax collection, and drastically reduced government spending to balance the budget and stabilize the franc. Holders of the national debt lost 80% of the face value of their bonds, but runaway inflation did not occur from 1926 to 1929. The French economy prospered and manufacturing flourished. Foreign observers in the 1920s noted the excesses of the French upper classes, but emphasized the rapid rebuilding of the regions of northeastern France that had seen warfare and occupation. They reported the improvement of financial markets, the brilliance of the post-war literature, and the revival of public morale. Great Depression. Main article: Great Depression in France. The World economic crisis known as the Great Depression affected France a bit later than other countries, hitting around 1931, while the GDP in the 1920s grew at the very strong rate of 443% per year. The 1930s rate fell to only 0.63% in comparison to countries such as the United States, Great Britain, and Germany. The depression was relatively mild. Unemployment peaked under 5%, and the fall in production was at most 20% below the 1929 output. In addition, there was no banking crisis. Foreign policy was of central interest to France during the interwar period. The horrible devastation of the war, including the death of 15 Czechoslovakia, Romania, Yugoslavia and the Soviet Union. There was little effort to build up the military strength or technological capabilities of these small allies, and they remained weak and divided among themselves in the end. The alliances proved worthless. France also constructed a powerful defensive wall in the form of a network of fortresses along its German border. It was called the Maginot Line and was trusted to compensate for the heavy manpower losses of the First World War. The main goal of foreign policy was the diplomatic response to the demands of the French army in the 1920s and 1930s to form alliances against the German threat, especially with Britain and with smaller countries in Central Europe. Appeasement was increasingly adopted as Germany grew stronger after 1933, for France suffered a stagnant economy, unrest in its colonies, and bitter internal political fighting. Appeasement, says historian Martin Thomas, was not a coherent diplomatic strategy or a copying of the British. France appeased Italy on the Ethiopia question because it could not afford to risk an alliance between Italy and Germany when Hitler sent troops into the Rhineland, the part of Germany where no troops were allowed. Neither Paris nor London would risk war, and nothing was done. The military alliance with Czechoslovakia was sacrificed at Hitler's demand when France and Britain agreed to his terms at Munich in 1938. The Popular Front. Main articles: Popular Front. France and Léon Blum. In 1920, the socialist movement split, with the majority forming the French Communist Party. The minority, led by Léon Blum, kept the name socialist, and by 1932 greatly outnumbered the disorganized communists when Stalin told French communists to collaborate with others on the left. In 1934, a Popular Front was made possible with an emphasis on unity against fascism. In 1936, the socialists and the radicals formed a coalition, with communists support, to complete it the Popular Front's narrow victory in the elections of the spring of 1936 brought to power a government headed by the socialists in alliance with the radicals. The communists supported its domestic policies, but did not take any seats in the cabinet. The prime minister was Léon Blum, a technocratic socialist who avoided making decisions in 2 years in office. It focused on labor law changes sought by the trade unions, especially the mandatory 40-hour work week, down from 48 hours. All workers were given a two-week paid vacation. A collective bargaining law facilitated union growth. Membership soared from 1 million to 5 million in 1 year, and workers' political strength was enhanced when the communist and non-communist unions joined together. The government nationalized the armaments industry and tried to seize control of the Bank of France in an effort to break the power of the richest 200 families in the country. Farmers received higher prices, and the government purchased surplus wheat, but farmers had to pay higher taxes. Wave after wave of strikes hit French industry in 1936. Wage rates went up 48%, but the work week was cut back by 17%, and the cost of living rose 46%, so there was little real gain to the average worker. The higher prices for French products resulted in a decline in overseas sales, which the government tried to neutralize by devaluing the franc, a measure that led to a reduction in the value of bonds and savings accounts. The overall result was significant damage to the French economy, and a lower rate of growth. Most historians judge the Popular Front a failure, although some call it a partial success. There is general agreement that it failed to live up to the expectations of the left politically. The Popular Front fell apart over Blum's refusal to intervene vigorously in the Spanish Civil War, as demanded by the communists culturally. The Popular Front forced the communists to come to terms with elements of French society they had long ridiculed, such as patriotism, the veteran's sacrifice, the honor of being an army officer, the prestige of the bourgeois, and the leadership of the Socialist Party and the Parliamentary Republic. Above all, the communists portrayed themselves as French nationalists. Young communists dressed in costumes from the revolutionary period, and the scholars glorified the Jacobins as heroic predecessors. Conservatism. Historians have turned their attention to the right in the interwar period, looking at various categories of conservatives and Catholic groups, as well as the far-right fascist movement. Conservative supporters of the old order were linked with the haute bourgeoisie, upper middle class, as well as nationalism, military power, the maintenance of the empire, and national security. The favorite enemy was the left, especially as represented by socialists. The conservatives were divided on foreign affairs. Several important conservative politicians sustained the journal Gringoire, foremost among them André Tardieu. The Revue des Durmandes, with its prestigious past and sharp articles, was a major conservative organ. Summer camps and youth groups were organized to promote conservative values in working-class families, and help them design a career path. The Croix de Feu, Parti Social Français CF, PSF, was especially active. Relations with Catholicism. France's republican government had long been strongly anti-clerical. The law of separation of church and state in 1905 had expelled many religious orders, declared all church buildings government property, and led to the closing of most church schools since that time. Pope Benedict XV had sought a rapprochement, but it was not achieved until the reign of Pope Pius XI 1922-39 in the papal encyclical Maximum Gravissimum Quo 1924. Many areas of dispute were tacitly settled and a bearable coexistence made possible.